Penguin Random House Audio presents Wise Gals, The Spies Who Built the CIA and Changed the Future of Espionage by Nathalia Holt. Read for you by Erin Bennett. For the women who toil, invisible, invaluable. For Lori. Put yourself behind my eyes and see me as I see myself, for I have chosen to dwell in a place you cannot see. Jalal al-Din Muhammad Rumi. Author's note. The wise gals are no longer with us to tell their stories, and yet they still speak. This work of nonfiction was researched thanks to the materials they left behind, which include diaries, letters, interviews, reports, memos, scrapbooks, and photographs. In addition to these sources, the Central Intelligence Agency has released primary documents about the careers of these women and the challenges they faced. All the work published in this book is declassified and was obtained through the Freedom of Information Act. A large portion of this book is credited to the CIA officers, both retired and active, who contributed their stories and memories. Just like the work these men and women perform, their contributions to the book remain anonymous. For this reason, their names appear as redacted in the source notes, and their own stories, while worthy of telling, have mostly been left out. First-hand accounts of historical events are often slanted by those who have lived through them. To limit this, I have used material from archival sources, acquired from multiple countries, to ensure that the material I obtain through these interviews is factual. Occasionally, material obtained from an interview was unable to be supported through outside sources. In these instances, I've weighed other evidence and carefully checked dates and timing when deciding whether to include these portions within the book. When I've chosen to include these firsthand histories without supporting documentation, I've noted the instance in the endnotes. The thoughts and feelings of individuals in the book were obtained through their personal materials and author interviews with those who knew them. All quoted material is obtained directly from primary sources and credited in the endnotes. This is the kind of book the wise gals could not have anticipated would ever be written. In their later years, they watched as their male colleagues became the subjects of multiple biographies, while their lives and accomplishments remained undocumented. Sadly, their stories could not have been told while the women were still with us. If living, neither the identities of the women nor their work within the agency would have been disclosed by the CIA. It is only in death that the full measure of their accomplishments can be revealed. November 1953. A small group of women gathered together just a few blocks from the White House to contemplate the dismal future of American intelligence. They had spent the past decade forming the fledgling American espionage enterprise known as the Central Intelligence Agency, breaking new ground for women in the workplace by working alongside men in dangerous, important operations. They'd played an integral part in gathering the intelligence that had won World War II for the Allies, and now they were on the front lines of the Cold War, spreading their network of spies across the world. But at this moment, these female founders were taking a rare opportunity to look inward. And what they saw made them angry. Eloise Page wasn't the kind of woman who was prone to emotional outbursts. Her friends would tell you that when she was upset, her demeanor was usually icy rather than explosive. She had a firm sense of right and wrong, and she never hesitated to reprimand those who crossed a line. Yet on this unusually balmy day in Washington, D.C., her temper was fiery. For the past few months, Eloise and a group of 22 of her female colleagues at the CIA had tackled a seemingly impossible goal: to strip away the inherent sexism that plagued the institution they loved. Women were doing the same work as their male counterparts, Eloise and her colleagues argued, but they weren't getting the same pay or recognition as the men they worked alongside each day. That had to change. To accomplish this, they had carefully documented the experiences of women at the agency over the course of years. The daring missions, the enormous responsibility. These women had given everything to safeguard America's security. In fact, some of their colleagues had even given their lives. Eloise and the other women knew that achieving their aim of equal pay and recognition for their work would not be easy. They met in the evenings, after their regular workday was over, gathering statistics and stories that would prove their case to the higher-ups at the CIA. While the group was officially named the Committee on Professional Women, everyone at the agency jokingly called them the Petticoat Panel. It became a nickname they loathed but adopted nevertheless as a reminder of exactly what they were up against. For Eloise, who had spent years overseas working in complex CIA operations, the task before them was rather mundane. They compiled numbers from each department of the agency, took into account the education and work experience of every employee, combined the dry statistics with personal anecdotes, and then prepared their reports. Yet their training in covert operations was aiding their progress in ways their male managers could not have predicted. As they interviewed female employees, they peeled off the niceties that people naturally coded their experiences in and exposed what a career in government service truly looked like if you were a woman. What they found wasn't pretty. Repeatedly, they heard frustration in their colleagues' voices. The number one reason that women were leaving the CIA was not marriage or pregnancy, as so many executives claimed. Instead, their interviews revealed a deep dissatisfaction among women, specifically concerning their promotion within the agency. Although 40% of the CIA's workforce in 1952 was made up of women, only 20% had reached a mid-range salary level, about $7,514 a year. This was compared with 70% of their male colleagues who were paid at that level. The problem wasn't that the women weren't being given responsibility either. It was that they weren't being paid for it. Many female employees had advanced degrees and were directing the activities of large teams. They had worked on successful operations and had years of experience in the field. In many cases, they even had the support of male colleagues and the recommendations of their bosses. Yet they couldn't get a raise. As she looked around the room, Eloise realized that she had never worked so closely with a group of women before. No matter whether she was in London, Brussels, Paris, or Washington, D.C., it seemed she was always in a room of men. Nor had she ever known her fellow CIA officers so well. After all, they were, by nature and by profession, a secretive bunch, often scattered around the world in various sensitive locales. But the Petticoat Panel was a chance for her and the other women in the CIA to meet and open up to one another in a way they weren't usually able to when on the job. While delving into the experiences of the women of their agency, it was only natural for them to share their own backgrounds. When one of her colleagues asked Eloise how she'd managed to secure a promotion from secretary to officer from General William Donovan, the father of American intelligence, after the war, she responded, "Oh, I had the goods on Donovan," a wicked smile on her lips. Everyone loved the lively Elizabeth Sutmeyer, whom they called Liz. She had grown up on a reservation in South Dakota and liked to tease her friends in the Lakota Sioux language. She had recently completed junior officer training, also called JOT, and was the only woman in her class, so she could report directly on gender discrepancies in CIA instruction and mentoring. "Women in the JOT program need to be more highly qualified than most of the men," she said. Then there was Mary Hutchison, a woman who had first been dismissed by the agency as a contract wife. The term referred to a woman married to a CIA officer, who was assumed to be trained and employed by the agency merely because of her marriage. Such roles were often entry points for women into the CIA, but Mary, with her proficiency in several languages, her doctorate in archaeology, and her string of fiery comebacks, was uniquely suited for a career in espionage. If only she could get the higher-ups at the CIA to notice her exemplary work. Eloise had grown closest to the chairwoman of their group, Adelaide Hawkins, whom she called Addie. They were the same age, they both hailed from small towns in the South, and they each had joined the CIA during World War II, before it even officially existed, when it had gone by the moniker OSS, or Office of Strategic Services. Friendly as they were, Eloise sensed Addie's envy of her overseas assignments. While Eloise had spent years in Europe, Addie, a divorced mom with three children, had been bound stateside. It didn't matter that Addie's children were grown, that fathers were allowed to work overseas, or even that she was highly qualified for such positions.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.